Section 26 of Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 7. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Reading by Matt Berard. Library of the World's Best Literature, Ancient and Modern, Volume 7, by various authors. Section 26. Hudibras, described by Samuel Butler. Samuel Butler, 1612 to 1680. A pretty picture of the time is the glimpse of young Mr. Pepys at the bookseller's in London Strand on a February morning in 1663, making haste to buy a new copy of Hudibras, and carefully explaining that it was ill humor of him to be so against that which all the world cries up to be an example of wit. The clerk of the Admiralty had connections at court, and between that February morning and a December day when Mr. Battersby was at the wardrobe using the king's time in gossip about the new book of drollery, the merry steward had found out Sam Butler's poem and had given it the help of his royal approval. Erstwhile, Samuel, the courtier, had thought the work of Samuel, the poet, silly, and had given warranty of his opinion by suffering loss of 1 shilling 8 pence on his purchase of the book. A view not to be wondered at in one who sets down Midsummer Night's Dream as insipid and ridiculous, and Othello as a mean thing. Perhaps it was because Butler had a keen knowledge of Shakespeare, and unconsciously used much of the actor's quick-witted method, that his delicately feathered barbs made no dent on the hard head of Pepys. Like his neighbor of the Avon, the author of Hudibras was a merciless scourge to the vainglorious follies of the time in which he poorly and obscurely lived, and like the truths which he told in his inimitable satires, the virtue and decency of his life was obscured by the disorder of the Commonwealth and the unfaith of the restored monarchy. Samuel Butler was born near Strensham, Worcestershire, in 1612, the fifth child and second son of a farmer of that parish, whose homestead was known to within the present century as Butler's Tenement. The elder Butler was not well to do, but had enough to educate his son at Worcester Grammar School and to send him to a university. Whether or what time he was at Oxford or Cambridge remains doubtful. A. Samuel Butler went up from Westminster to Christchurch, Oxford, 1623, too soon for the Worcester lad of 11 years. Another doubtful tradition places him at Cambridge in 1620. There is evidence that he was employed as a clerk by Mr. Jeffreys, a justice of the peace at Earl's Croom in Worcestershire, and that while in this position he studied painting under Samuel Cooper. A portrait of Oliver Cromwell attributed to his hand was once in existence, and a number of paintings said to have been by him hung on the walls at Earl's Croom until they were used to patch broken windows there in the last century. Butler went into the service of Elizabeth, Countess of Kent, at Rest in Bedfordshire, where he had the use of a good library and the friendship of John Selden, then steward of the Countess's estate. It was there and in association with Selden that he began his literary work. Sometime afterward, he held a servitor's position in the family of an officer of Cromwell's army, Sir Samuel Luke, at Woodend, Bedfordshire. A manuscript note in an old edition of Hudibras, 1710, from the books of Phil Lomax by gift of his father, G. Lomax, confirms the tradition that his Cromwellian colonel was the original of Hudibras. The elder Lomax is said to have been an intimate friend of Butler. Another name on the list of candidates for this humorous honor, the honor of contributing with Don Quixote to the increase of language, is that of Sir Henry Rosewell of Ford Abbey, Devonshire. But it is unnecessary to limit to an individual sample the satirist and poet of the whole breadth of human nature. A presumption that Butler was in France and Holland for a time arises from certain references in his writings. It was about 1659, when the decline of the Cromwells became assured, that Butler ventured, but anonymously, into print with a tract warmly advocating the recall of the king. At the Restoration, and probably in reward for this evidence of loyalty, he was made secretary to the Earl of Carbury, President of Wales, by whom he was appointed steward of Ludlow Castle. About this time he married a gentlewoman of small fortune, and is said to have lived comfortably upon her money until it was lost by bad investments. The king having come to his own again, Butler obtained permission in November 1662 to print the first part of Hudibras. The quaint title of this poem has attracted much curious cavil. The name is used by Milton, Spenser, and Robert of Gloucester for an early king of Britain, the grandfather of King Lear, and by Ben Jonson, from whom Butler evidently adopted it, for a swaggering fellow in The Magnetic Lady. Where is your captain? Hudibras, the Ironside. Act 3, Scene 3. Charles II was so delighted with the satire that he not only read and reread it, but gave many copies to his intimates. The royal generosity, lavish in promises, never exerted itself further than to give Butler, or Butler, as he is writ in the warrant, a monopoly of printing his own poem. The second part of Hudibras appeared in 1664, and the third and last in 1678. The Duke of Buckingham was, we are told by Aubrey, well disposed toward Butler, and Wycherley was a constant suitor in his behalf. But the fickle favorite forgot his promises as easily as did the king. Lord Clarendon, who had the witty poet's portrait painted for his library, was no better at promise-keeping. It is natural that such neglect should have provoked the sharp but just satires which Butler wrote against the manners of Charles' dissolute court. Hudibras was never finished, for Butler, who had been confined by his infirmities to his room in Rose Court, Covent Garden, since 1676, died on September 25th, 1680. William Longueville, a devoted friend, but for whose kindness the poet might have starved, buried the remains at his own expense in the churchyard of St. Paul's, Covent Garden. In 1721, John Barber, Lord Mayor of London, set up in the poet's corner of Westminster Abbey an inscription to Butler's memory, which caused later satirists to suggest that this was giving a stone to him who had asked for bread. Butler was a plain man of middle stature, strong set, high-colored, with a head of sorrel hair. He possessed a severe and sound judgment, but was a good fellow, according to his friend Aubrey. Many of Butler's writings were not published in his lifetime, during which only the three parts of Hudibras and some trifles appeared. Longueville, who received his papers, left them, unpublished, to his son Charles, from whom they came to John Clark of Cheshire, by whose permission the genuine remains in two volumes were published in 1759. The title of this book is due to the fact that poor Butler, as is usual with his kind, became very popular immediately after his death, and the ghouls of literature supplied the bookshops with forgeries. Butler's manuscripts, many of which have never been published, were placed in the British Museum in 1885. Hudibras described. When civil fury first grew high, and men fell out, they knew not why. When hard words, jealousies, and fears set folks together by the ears, and made them fight like mad or drunk, for dame religion as for punk, whose honesty they all durst swear for, though not a man of them knew wherefore. When Gospel-Trumpeter surrounded with long-eared rout to battle sounded, and pulpit, drum, ecclesiastick was beat with fist instead of a stick, then did Sir Knight abandon dwelling, and out he rode, a colonelling. A wight he was, whose very sight would entitle him mirror of knighthood, that never bent his stubborn knee to anything but chivalry, nor put up blow but that which laid right worshipful on shoulder blade, chief of domestic knights and errant, either for chartel or for warrant, great on the bench, great in the saddle, that could as well wind o'er as swaddle. Mighty he was at both of these, and styled of war as well as peace. So some rats of amphibious nature are either. So some rats of amphibious nature are either for the land or water. But here our authors made a doubt whether he were more wise or stout. Some held the one and some the other. But howsoever, they made a pother. The difference was so small, his brain outweighed his rage but half a grain, which made some take him for a tool that knaves do work with, called a fool, and offered to lay wagers that, as Montaigne, playing with his cat, complained she thought him but an ass, much more she would have Sir Hudibras. For that's the name our valiant knight to all his challenges to did write, but they're mistaken very much. 'Tis plain enough he was no such. We grant, although he had much wit, he was very shy of using it, as being loath to wear it out, and therefore bore it not about, unless on holy days or so, as men their best apparel do. He was in logic a great critic, profoundly skilled in analytic. He could distinguish and divide a hair 'twixt south and southwest side. On either side he would dispute, confute, change hands, and still confute. He'd undertake to prove by force of argument a man's no horse. He'd prove a buzzard is no fowl, and that a lord may be an owl, a calf, an alderman, a goose, a justice, and rooks, committee, men, or trustees. He'd run in debt by disputation, and pay with ratiocination. All this by syllogism true, in mood and figure, he would do. For rhetoric, he could not ope his mouth, but out there flew a trope, and when he happened to break off, in the middle of his speech, or cough, a hard words ready to show why, and tell what rules he did it by. Else, when with greatest art he spoke, you'd think he'd talked like other folk, for all a rhetorician's rules teach nothing but to name his tools. His ordinary rate of speech, in loftiness of sound, was rich, a Babylonish dialect, which learned pedants much affect. It was a parti-colored dress of patched and piebald languages. 'Twas English cut on Greek and Latin, like fustian heretofore on satin. It had an odd promiscuous tone, as if he had talked three parts in one, which made some think, when he did gabble, they had heard three laborers of Babel, or Cerberus himself, pronounce a leash of languages at once. This he as volubly would vent, as if his stock would ne'er be spent, and truly, to support that charge, he had supplies as vast and large, for he could coin or counterfeit new words with little or no wit. Words so debased and hard, no stone was hard enough to touch them on, and when with hasty noise he spoke 'em, the ignorant for current took 'em, that had the orator who once did fill his mouth with pebble stones. When he harangued but known his phrase, he would have used no other ways. In mathematics he was greater than Tycho Brahe or Arapater, for he, by geometric scale, could take the size of pots of ale, resolve by sines and tangents straight, if bread or butter wanted weight, and wisely tell what hour of the day the clock does strike by algebra. Besides, he was a shrewd philosopher, and had read every text and gloss over. Whate'er the crabbest author hath, he understood by implicit faith. Whatever skeptic could inquire for every why he had a wherefore, knew more than 40 of them do, as far as words and terms could go, all which he understood by rote, and as occasion served, would quote, no matter whether right or wrong, they might be either said or sung. His notions fitted things so well that which was which he could not tell, but oftentimes mistook the one for the other, as great clerks have done. He could reduce all things to acts, and knew their natures by abstracts, where entity and quiddity, the ghost of defunct bodies, fly. where truth in person does appear, like words congealed in northern air, he knew what's what, and that's as high as metaphysic wit can fly. For his religion, it was fit to match his learning and his wit. 'Twas Presbyterian true blue, for he was of that stubborn crew of errant saints whom all men grant to be the true church militant, such as do build their faith upon the holy text of pike and gun, decide all controversy by infallible artillery, and prove their doctrine orthodox by apostolic blows and knocks, call fire and sword and desolation a godly, thorough reformation, which always must be carried on, and still be doing, never done. As if religion were intended for nothing else but to be mended, a sect whose chief devotion lies in odd perverse antipathies, in falling out with that or this, and finding somewhat still amiss, more peevish, cross, and splenetic than dog distract or monkey sick, that with more care keep holy day the wrong than others the right way, compound for sins that are inclined to by damning those they have no mind to, still so perverse and opposite as if they worship God for spite, the self-same thing they will abhor one way and long another for, free will they one way disavow, another nothing else allow, all piety consists therein, in them, in other men, all sin, rather than fail, they will defy that which they love most tenderly, quarrel with minced pies and disparage their best and dearest friend, plum porridge, fat pig and goose itself oppose, and blaspheme custard through the nose. His puissant sword unto his side, near his undaunted heart was tied, with basket hilt that would hold broth and serve for fight and dinner both. In it he melted lead for bullets, to shoot at foes and sometimes pullets, to whom he bore so fell a grudge, he ne'er gave quarter to any such. The trenchant blade, Toledo, trusty, for want of fighting was grown rusty into itself, for lack of somebody to hew and hack. The peaceful scabbard where it dwelt, the rancor of its edge had felt. This sword a dagger had, his page, that was but little for his age, and therefore waited on him so, as dwarfs upon knights errant do. It was a serviceable dudgeon, either for fighting or for drudging. When it had stabbed or broke a head, it was grape trenchers or chip bread, toast cheese or bacon, though it were to bait a mousetrap, t'would not care. T'would make clean shoes and in the earth set leeks and onions and so forth. It had been prenticed to a brewer, where this and more it did endure, but left the trade, as many more have lately done on the same score. End of section 26.